Go on to the next paper by Dr. Ritika Malik. Dr. Ritika Malik, R23525, free paper number 1278, Next Generation Cross-Linking Calculator for Titration of Energy in Thin Keratoconic Cornea.
Good afternoon, everyone. And I would like to present my paper on the Next Generation Cross-Linking Calculator for Titration of Energy in Thin Keratoconic Corneas. I have no financial disclosures. So the management of keratoconus along with its safety and efficacy has been well established. Less than 450 microns, we can take the patient up for an epion cross-linking or an intracorneal ring segments. What about the patients with advanced disease? With scarring, we have to post them for keratoplasty. But now we come to a cohort of patients who have KC, advanced keratoconus and thin corneas without any scarring. How do we proceed in these cases? So do we do a normal collagen cross-linking for them? Or do we post them for a keratoconus transplant? So each of these modalities have their own limitations, such as endothelial toxicity is seen at less than 400 microns in normal collagen cross-linking in thin corneas. For corneal transplantation, the graft survivability is a major issue. So what are the other modalities, such as hypoosmolar riboflavin, transepithelial method, contact lens assisted, lenticule assisted, customized pachymetry guided, and iontophoresis? So higher order abrasions are not corrected in these cases, and unpredictable outcomes are there for these modalities. So this led to an idea that is there a simpler way of cross-linking the thinner corneas without scarring? So we stumbled upon a paper from Dr. Hafezi's team who customized UVA fluence according to the corneal thickness. So they described the principle of adapted fluence wherein customized energy is delivered by altering the irradiation time. That means the UVA irradiation time of 3 mW/cm². So this paper also gave us the stress relaxation curves for different conditions and stated that the effect of corneal collagen cross-linking is more dependent on the duration of the UV light than to the overall applied UV fluence. So this graph was derived from a multitude of complex formula, and we wanted to bring it to our clinics in an easier way. So we devised our own UV calculator. So leading us to a research question, is there a simpler way to calculate energy, titration, and time in thin corneas? The purpose of a study was to see the safety and efficacy of our own calculator. We designed our own UV calculator by using the Lambert-Beer equation to present a simple calculator to decide the UV on time. The process can be tailored based on the corneal thickness to deliver a cross-linking effect with an adequate safety zone. So this is how our calculator looks. The change in thickness changes the fluence time. So this is what gives us a 3 mW and a 9 mW range on the 0.1 and 0.2% riboflavin. So this is the epithelium off thickness chart corresponding to the time. So how did we go ahead with our study? We seeked ethics committee approval, and then we included 70 eyes of 70 patients who had advanced keratoconus, documented progression, less than 400 microns, and very importantly, no scarring. What did we evaluate preoperatively? We did the topography, the epithelial mapping, the specular microscopy, and did a customized cross-linking and with the help of our NHT. So what if you have a patient of 390 microns? We remove the epithelium of around 50 microns. We are left with 340 microns. We put this simply in our calculator, and this is giving us a 3 mW at 21.5 minutes and at 9 mW at 7.5 minutes. So with this, we can go ahead and do a cross-linking with 0.1% riboflavin. At 1, 3, and 6 months follow-up, we did a refraction, topography, specular microscopy, and ASOCT. The safety profile was very good, as we saw no haze on the pentacam or clinically. No change in the lines was seen in 51% of the cases, gain of one line in 24%, gain of two lines in 14%. So there was no statistically significant change in specular count. There was stable keratometry, good demarcation line in 62%, and good outcomes. Biomechanical stiffness was present in 35%, and PSOCT showed changes for the betterment. It was studying the collagen range and showed a stiffer cornea. So our calculator is freely downloadable. It is simple to use, and this is the URL and the QR code for our calculator. Thank you.
Ritika, I have got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So as you said already, and all of us, we know that C3R efficacy is dependent on the UV fluence. So yes, accordingly, you said that after the cases were taken who had less than 400 microns of yes, thickness. Yes. So have you ever tried the same formula using the cases which don't have apical scarring and they have thickness more than 420, 430, which needed C3R?
Yes, sir. So if they are more than 420 in their thickness range, if the epithelium off is coming around 390 or 380, it will again come to near about at 9 milliwatts fluence around at 9.5 minutes. So that is what the fluence calculator will give.
Yeah, yeah. No, my question is that if it is 470 and still is a progressive keratoconus, did you apply the same formula and did you get the same result as you claim to be in when you are applying the same formula for less than 400 microns of thickness?
No, sir. This was applied for the thin keratoconic corneas only.
And you have never applied for the corneas who had more than 450 microns, but is a progressive keratoconus, and you didn't apply for those cases?
No, sir. We did not post them with our NXT UV calculator because that will not give us the formulated result on a calculator. Our calculator will give the result when the epithelium off thickness is put in. So less than 400 microns TCT was put in our calculator and in our study.
Okay. Good.
Yes, doctor. Any questions from any of the judges? Please raise your hands. Yes, Sozin. Yes, Dr. Sozin, please.
Nice paper, Ritika. I wanted to know a couple of things. One is, what is the maximum Kmax that you took for your patients? Are you doing it for any steepness of cornea, or is there an upper limit?
So ma'am, the first thing we have to see is the thinness of cornea. So if it's 400 microns or less, we can, but Kmax also we can take about 64 Kmax is also a good, showed a good stability for us.
So your upper limit was 64.
Yes.
Okay. And also you said that you, in your calculations, you took it as about 50 microns for epithelium. Yes. But we know that the epithelium thickness is not uniform.
So we can change the epithelium thickness by seeing the MS39, doing the epithelial mapping, and then reducing that epithelium from the thickness of the cornea.
So does your calculator account for epithelial thickness as well?
Yes, ma'am. So we remove the epithelium and then put it in the calculator. So around, like, if it's 390, we remove 50 of the epithelium or 40 of the epithelium, however much it be. So we can put either 340 or 350, whatever we.
So basically, your calculator is entering. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah, Susan.
Also, what is the average demarcation line depth? I think you didn't mention the depth that you've got.
Sorry, ma'am, I didn't get the question.
What is the demarcation line depth that you've got?
So, ma'am, the demarcation line depth in various of the 62%, we got like a median demarcation line at around 200. And some of them were also a little superficial, but a good demarcation was line seen in most of the patients.
Any
and
other
you have
questions?
Not studied the variation between different types of riboflavins as far as the carrier is concerned?
No, ma'am. Currently, we are in the process of that. But with 0.1%, we have just seen the for this study currently.
With HPMC or dextran?
Sorry, ma'am.
What is the carrier? What is the carrier that was used for the riboflavin?
So with HPMC.
Any other questions from any of the other judges?